midichlorians.
So then George Lucas completely and utterly finally ruined Star Wars forever by having Qui-Gon explain that the Force is microscopic organisms. This entire idea and why this is in the movie is so baffling to me that I cannot even wrap my mind around it.
And just when he thought that the Star Wars saga couldn't get any more confusing, George Lucas decided to introduce midichlorians into the mix. That's right. Apparently everyone just has little microscopic organisms floating around the inside of their bodies, and whoever listens to them correctly can understand the Force.
It's not a mystical thing that binds us together with everyone in the galaxy, it's just these little organisms that live inside our body.
I felt a great disturbance in the Force, as if millions of voices suddenly cried out in terror and were suddenly silenced. I fear something terrible has happened.
This entire idea and why this is in the movie is so baffling to me that I cannot even wrap my mind around it.
I don't understand.
With time and training, Annie, you will. You will.
When I was a kid in a used bookstore one day, I found an old original copy of the novelization of the first Star Wars movie that came out before the movie was even released. If you've ever read it, then you know it starts off by saying that the book is from The Adventures of Luke Skywalker from the Journal of the Whills. Anytime we went into a bookstore for a while after that, I would ask them if they had a book called The Adventures of Luke Skywalker or The Journal of the Whills. And if they knew who Luke Skywalker was, they would show me their other Star Wars books, but of course they didn't have one with those titles. I didn't understand as a kid that it was a framing device. I thought that there actually had to be another longer book that the first Star Wars book was an excerpt from. When I knew that The Journal of the Whills book hadn't actually been released, I still wanted to know what those lines meant. Whatever the Whills were, Lucas had named them and he must have had some thoughts about them. Those lines kind of fascinated me because they told me that Star Wars was part of a bigger story that George Lucas had that we only knew one part of. So I wondered a lot, what were the Whills, why were they keeping this journal, and where did they get the story from? That was never really answered until a few recent interviews that Lucas has done. The answer, as it turns out, is stranger and more interesting than anything that we probably could have guessed, and I think it would change how most people view Star Wars. So, to explain what the Whills are, first I have to start by explaining midichlorians. Both because Lucas has recently explained more about midichlorians than we knew before, but also because people over the years that I've seen complaining about midichlorians, I don't think I've seen any of them, up to and definitely including J.J. Abrams, that have understood exactly what midichlorians actually are. I always thought the mythology and esoterica that Lucas created in his movies around the Force was really interesting, but whenever Lucas has tried to explain the Force mythology that he has, he's always been met with total, instant, irrational backlash from the fans. The very brief, simple scene of Qui-Gon introducing the concept of midichlorians to Anakin has probably been met with more hostility than anything else in all of Star Wars. As Lucas has explained in his recent interview with Paul Duncan for the Star Wars Archives books, midichlorians are a small organism similar to mitochondria. In the world of real science, mitochondria are organelles that travel within living cells. You might remember from high school biology that mitochondria are the powerhouse of the cell because they provide cells with energy that the cell needs in order to divide and do all the things that cells do. Specifically, in the Archives book, Lucas explains that midichlorians provided the energy which started the cells dividing to create Anakin. Additionally, mitochondria send signals to cells to communicate messages from hormones and your immune system, among other body systems, which leads to the cells carrying out corresponding functions. So when Lucas is talking about midichlorians, he's talking about a slightly fantasy version of a real thing. When he says they're telling us the will of the Force, it's not that different than actual mitochondria giving your cells directions based on signals that they're getting from hormones. But for some reason, this makes fans go absolutely insane. Fans think that this somehow is a scientific explanation of the Force, which they want to be mysterious and magical. As anybody who's actually seen J.J. Abrams' Star Wars movies knows, J.J. Abrams doesn't have the first clue about Star Wars, so he repeats this popular misconception.
Does anyone ever mention midichlorians?
In the movie? No.
He said in 2019, before The Rise of Skywalker came out, "What I remember when I was a kid and I saw the first film and Obi-Wan Kenobi talks about the Force and how it surrounds all of us and binds every living thing together, and that feeling of that kind of power, to me, is the thing that I've always felt was a bit more powerful of an idea." But of course, explaining midichlorians doesn't actually explain anything about the Force. The Force is a completely separate thing from the midichlorians that the midichlorians are acting in response to. Lucas goes on to explain that the Force is exactly what it's always been. It's an energy field created by living things. He divides the Force into two types: the personal Force, or living Force, which is your own energy that we generate by being alive, by cells dividing, by taking in and processing oxygen, or by plants converting sunlight and photosynthesis, things like that.
"But Master Yoda said I should be mindful of the future."
"But not at the expense of the moment. Be mindful of the living Force, young Padawan."
"Living beings generate the living Force, which in turn powers the wellspring that is the cosmic Force. All energy from the living Force, from all things that have ever lived, feeds into the cosmic Force, binding everything and communicating to us through the midichlorians."
By the way, when I use clips from a couple Clone Wars episodes to explain some of these things, they're from one particular story that we know Lucas was involved in, and he mentions that story specifically in the Star Wars Archives book as explaining some of his ideas on these things, so I think we can be confident that these explanations fit with what he's trying to say. So by being alive, we're generating a personal energy field, and he says that what the Jedi do is manage to have some more control over that energy than normal people do, or than most people do. That's what a Jedi is doing when he's levitating something or force pushing something. Now, the other aspect of the Force is what Lucas calls the cosmic Force. This is the energy they talk about that binds the galaxy together. It's the same mystic energy field, but the energy that's not currently coming from one individual living creature. He says that when a person dies, they lose their identity and their personal Force joins the cosmic Force.
"Everything that we know about the Force tells us that an individual retaining their identity after death is impossible."
"Everything that we know, yes. But what about what we know not,
"The dead are part of the cosmic Force and lose their individuality."
"Midichlorians, the foundation of what connects the living Force and the cosmic Force. When a living thing dies, all is renewed. Life passes from the living Force into the cosmic Force and becomes one with it. One powers the other. One is renewed by the other."
This is, again, a mythological way to talk about a real thing, which is that whatever energy is in our bodies when we die becomes part of the impersonal energy of the universe, but it doesn't disappear. How that personal energy that your body generates when you're alive relates to your individual persona is something that we don't fully understand, because it gets into questions of where our self-awareness exists and whether we have a soul or something like a soul. But if Lucas is saying that the personal Force constitutes our persona, then calling it a soul is another way of describing it. For how Lucas is accused of giving overly scientific explanations to things, he's still dealing with the spiritual theme here, regardless of what terminology you're using. So what Lucas clearly says is that in his mythology, when we die, our energy is assimilated into the cosmic Force. Whatever it was that made our individual persona or personality hasn't gone away, but rather it's now part of the energy field of the universe, or the larger intelligence from which it came, if we're to assume that the cosmic Force has an intelligence. But I'll get back to that idea in a minute. Part of what people, including J.J. Abrams, object to is that they think the idea that only people with midichlorians can be what we call Force-sensitive is a change to how things were in the original trilogy. This is just simply wrong. First, in the original trilogy, whether they said it was because of your midichlorians or not, obviously some people were more inclined to be able to use the Force in a Jedi-like way than other people were. There's a reason that training Luke would have had a different outcome than training Han Solo. Some people have more of an inclination than others, and this was clear in the original trilogy before midichlorians were ever mentioned, and midichlorians didn't change anything about that. It was also clear that this inclination to use the Force is in some ways genetic or inherited and passed through family lines.
"Force is strong in my family. My father has it. I have it. And my sister has it."
So when the people say that the idea of a Jedi needing midichlorians in some way limits who can become a Jedi more than it was previously limited in the original trilogy, that's just simply talking nonsense. It's not what's in the movies. Lucas goes on to explain in the archives book that everybody has midichlorians, and everybody has a personal force, an energy field that they're generating, just like the Jedi do. If that energy field constitutes your persona, as Lucas says it does, then to say that only Jedi have this power is like saying that nobody else has souls. This obviously is not what he means, not what he's trying to say. Everybody has midichlorians, and everybody has a personal force. What Jedi have is a predisposition to be able to do things with their personal force that other people can't, or that it would be much more difficult for other people to do. Lucas explains it as having a natural aptitude for math or piano or something like that. Luke might have an aptitude for telepathy or telekinesis, but because his brain can do that and Han's can't, it doesn't mean that Han doesn't have a brain. Another thing that people misunderstand is that they think if you can use the force, that means you're a Jedi, or if you can use the dark side, that means you're a Sith. Jedi and Sith are not the light side and the dark side exclusively. They're simply religious orders that try to learn about those things. So somebody might not become a Jedi or might not have enough midichlorians for Jedi training, but that doesn't mean that the Force isn't working through them or with them. What the Jedi or Sith or other orders of Force-sensitive people in the Star Wars universe are doing is passing on specific knowledge and techniques and value systems. Lucas compares it to Buddhist monks who learn to walk on hot coal. He says repeatedly that the Jedi aren't superheroes or superhuman. They're just like us, but they've learned special skills. In his analogy about an aptitude for piano, he says that you might be born with an aptitude, but you don't just wake up one day and decide you're a concert-level pianist. You still need to be trained, and that's what an order like the Jedi is. He says that obviously you don't just wake up one day and decide that now you want to see the future. In the interviews, he repeats again and again that the difference between a Jedi and a normal person is just training, that to use the Force, you have to be trained. This interview took place shortly after he had seen a certain film called The Force Awakens, but I'm sure these comments weren't reacting to anything in particular in that movie.
You will remove these restraints and leave this cell with the door open.
I will remove these restraints and leave the cell with the door open.
That's not how the Force works.
I'm curious that the Force doesn't get muddled into a bunch of garbly gook.
Okay, so we've established the non-scientific explanation of what the Force is and how the Jedi use it, but the thing that's not explained is that the Jedi say that the Force has a will and that it guides things. So there seems to be an intelligence to the Force, and it's communicating to us what it wants. Jedi are more aware of this because they have more midichlorians signaling to them what the Force wants, but how do the midichlorians know this? That question is actually what brings us to the Whills. The Whills, W-H-I-L-L-S, whatever those are, have obviously always been important to Lucas's conception of Star Wars, since he frames the entire story as being from the Journal of the Whills. In spite of that, though, until a couple years ago, there have only been a few mentions of them in the canon of Star Wars. In the Making of Revenge of the Sith book by J.W. Rensler, Lucas says that the story of Star Wars was told by R2-D2 to a Keeper of the Whills roughly 100 years after Return of the Jedi. Now, Lucas has said many times over the years that Star Wars is all basically R2's story. This is why R2 gets the first close-up in Attack of the Clones to frame the action as being seen from R2's point of view.
I also like the fact that R2 is actually the first character that gets a close-up and is introduced into the movie. It's ultimately R2's story.
It's also why he's always there as a witness to important events that nobody else would have been a witness to. For example, R2's there on Mustafar when Anakin slaughters the Separatists. So R2 would have known about that event when Sidious and Anakin would have been the only other people alive who did. He would be able to explain, more than most other people, how and when Anakin became Darth Vader. Another example is that R2 is a witness at Anakin and Padme's wedding, which is another secret thing that nobody else would have known about afterward, after the key participants had died. This is also why, back before Revenge of the Sith came out, you could have predicted that 3PO would have had his mind wiped, but R2 wouldn't. It's played like as a joke that Bail Organa thinks to wipe 3PO's memory, but doesn't think it's important to wipe R2's memory, because R2 doesn't talk, but R2 actually knows more secrets than anybody. It also explains all the questions people had after the prequels about how the droids didn't remember the people that they had met before. R2 did remember. He knows exactly what he's doing. 3PO's the one in the original trilogy that's confused. Owen and Beru, on the other hand, wouldn't recognize 3PO or R2 because there are a million other droids in Star Wars who look exactly like those two. So the framing device of Star Wars is that this story is being told by R2 to a keeper of the Whills who writes it into the Journal of the Whills. So how does R2 know a keeper of the Whills, and how does he tell them this story? That's never actually spelled out in the movies, but I think Lucas actually wanted to give us the pieces to figure it out. The other major notable mention of the Whills that we have from Lucas is in the Revenge of the Sith screenplay, where he says that Qui-Gon learned the secret to immortality by talking with somebody called a Shaman of the Whills. In a version of the script, he also said that Qui-Gon had learned this by studying with the Ancient Order of the Whills. In the Archives book, Lucas specifically mentions the Clone Wars episode Voices, where Yoda follows Qui-Gon's direction to meet five Force priestesses on a planet that's called the Wellspring of Life, which is described as being where the midichlorians come from.
Now we find Master Yoda deep in space, searching for a path to ones who will teach him all he does not know of the Force. What is this place?
All that surrounds us is the foundation of life, the birthplace of what Jewish science calls midichlorians.
Now, whether the Force Priestesses and the Shaman of the Whills are the same thing hasn't been specifically said, but at two points Lucas has said that Qui-Gon learned how to retain his persona from the Shaman of the Whills, and also said that he learned the same thing from those Force Priestesses. So I think when he's talking about both, he's talking about the same thing, or at least they're in some way working together.
At death, in order for you to preserve your identity, you must know yourself, your true self. And then let go.
So if those characters in that Clone Wars episodes are the Shaman of the Whills, or that's where the Shaman of the Whills are, because that's where Qui-Gon learned his secret to immortality, an interesting thing about that episode is that when Yoda goes to visit these shaman, who does Yoda bring with him?
Hey R2, I have a mission for you.
Yoda brings R2-D2, of all people, to go meet the shaman. So the Shaman of the Whills, or the Keeper of the Whills, or the Force Priestesses, I think we can assume are all the same character, and in this episode they're laying out how R2 knew about them, and how he could later tell them his story for their Journal of the Whills. So these Force Priestesses are the ones who explain to Qui-Gon how he could keep his identity when he dies and he joins the Cosmic Force. After he did that, he still had his identity when he was one with the larger Force, so he was able to communicate what he had learned about it back to Yoda.
It is I. Qui-Gon Jinn.
That cannot be. Dead you are.
No. I am part of the Living Force, Yoda.
Qui-Gon was supposed to have been the first to do this, so he hasn't mastered it to the point where he could become a corporeal ghost and keep some version of his physical body like the other characters who later became Force ghosts do, like Yoda or Obi-Wan or Anakin.
Show yourself. Can you?
I cannot. My training was incomplete.
When they died, they knew more about the Cosmic Force from what Qui-Gon had taught them, Qui-Gon being the first individual who was able to report back to them about it.
You will learn to preserve your life force, and so manifest a consciousness which will allow you to commune with the living after death.
What this has to do with the Force Priestesses is that it's explained that they were individuals who had died, but an echo of them was still there on the Wellspring of Life planet.
Now you see, we have achieved what you seek and live between the realms.
Dead you are?
Yes.
Like Qui-Gon, after he's died, the Force Priestesses don't have bodies, and so they use masks and props as tools to represent themselves and communicate with the living. They're sort of a voice of the Force, or a voice from the netherworld of the Force. So we have the Shaman of the Whills, the Keeper of the Whills, and the midichlorians, who are all kind of emissaries of the Whills, but not the Whills themselves. My idea had always kind of been that the Whills were like interdimensional beings that existed on a different level of consciousness than humans do, and it turns out that that's sort of right, in a way. A couple years ago, in an interview with James Cameron, Lucas made some cryptic comments where he said that to the Whills, we are basically just cars or vehicles, and that in a way they were controlling everything we did. Now, Lucas has talked several times about circular levels of reality, about rings within rings. This is what I've always thought Qui-Gon's line was about.
There's always a bigger fish.
Meaning in one way that humans think that we're running things, and the Sith are especially obsessed with power. Ah! But while Sidious might think that he's running the show, the Whills are actually running him, and so on and so on. There's always a bigger fish. But what it turns out is, I think that that's actually a little bit of a pun as far as, you know, size matters not, because when Lucas is talking about the bigger fish, if the Whills are the bigger fish, it turns out that the Whills are actually a microscopic single-celled organism. In the Archives book, Lucas explains that the Whills are a microscopic creature like amoeba that live inside humans and inside other living creatures. The idea is loosely based on the microbiome that humans actually have inside of us. In a human body, there are as many other living, microscopic, and single-celled creatures as there are human cells. A single human is actually host to billions or even trillions of other living creatures.
Turns out, you're all superorganisms. Sounds pretty cool, right? A superorganism is basically an organism made up of many smaller organisms. Think of it like a city. All the people who live and work there have their own lives, but they rely on each other for things like food, clothing, and other services. Together, they bring the city to life. Microbes living in your body play an essential role in keeping you alive and well. These are just a few of the bacteria, fungi, and viruses that call the human body their home. We call this rich ecosystem of non-human cells the microbiome.
He says the Whills feed off the Force, and the more of the Force there is, the better off they are. In order for the energy field to be thriving, they need it to be in balance, balance between the light and the dark side. Whereas before I might have guessed that a shaman of the Whills actually was a Will in some way, whatever that was. I think that what Lucas actually means is that the shaman is an individual who communicates with them or studies them. The Journal of the Whills most likely isn't actually written by the Whills, but by these shaman of the Whills to record what they've actually learned about the Whills or learned from the Whills. So what happens actually is that the Whills can use the midichlorians to direct events by sending them into our cells with messages. Midichlorians, like we talked about, could cause cell division or other cell functions, and could in that way tell us the will of the Whills. The Whills are sensitive to the Force on a cosmic level, so if they feel that something is out of balance, they can direct things on a cellular level to try to fix it. Like they could, for example, have the midichlorians cause cell division that would create a boy who is also full of midichlorians, and then try to direct his fate. They could also send signals to Qui-Gon when Qui-Gon meets this boy that the boy is somebody he should pay attention to.
Finding him was the will of the Force. I have no doubt of that.
The question this raises then is about free will and about how much control the Whills have over us. The name Whills with an H is obviously a pun on will, as in free will or the will of the Force.
There's no mystical energy field controls my destiny.
Now, humans and everybody else always wants to think that they're the ones running the show and that they're in charge of what they do. But while we might act like we're running things, there are always bigger forces at work.
You stay here. We'll take care of this.
I have decided that we shall stay here.
Send a scanning crew aboard. I want every part of this ship checked.
Yes, sir. Get me a scanning crew in here on the double. I want every part of this ship checked.
This has been a central theme in Star Wars since the very beginning. Aside from things like Han Solo bristling at the idea that a mystical energy field might control him, the movies constantly raise the issue of masters and apprentices and of fathers and sons.
He's our new master.
When I left you, I was but the learner. Now I am the master.
I need your help, son.
The idea is that to us, we're all the hero of our own story, but that doesn't mean we're the center of the universe.
There's always a bigger fish.
This is something Lucas has played with since how he chose to tell the story of the first movie. You might consider that movie Luke's story, but Lucas chooses to tell it mostly from the point of view of the droids. He's talked many times about how he thought it was interesting to tell the story from the point of view of the lowliest characters in that social hierarchy. Luke might think that it's all his story, but in the end, R2 is the one telling that story to us. This is a smaller reflection of how Palpatine might think that he has all the power, but in the end, he's actually a character in the Journal of the Whills, and he's a character that eventually dies, as all characters do, no matter how much power they might have when they're alive. This is coming back to the idea again that there are different levels of reality and different perspectives, and that it's subjective to our own point of view.
So what I told you was true, from a certain point of view.
All that's about what Lucas is trying to say about there being circles within circles and different levels of existence.
The circle is now complete.
Now I am complete.
For 3PO, the data inside of him, the electrical signals inside of him that store his memories, constitute his persona, like Lucas would say that our personal force, or the energy within us, constitutes who we are. When those memories are erased, the energy inside 3PO goes from having a specific message or specific data to being dissipated energy, the way Lucas says our personalities are absorbed into the cosmic force when we die. Yet in spite of that, when Bail Organa tells them to wipe 3PO's memories, Lucas told Jimmy Smits to deliver this line casually like he was telling them to clean an appliance. Us being a car to the Whills is like 3PO being basically just a toaster or an appliance to humans. Lucas told A New Hope from the droid's point of view because he thought it was an interesting idea to tell the story from the point of view of the lowliest creatures in that society. This is another example of how Lucas always says he's doing riffs on the same themes from different points of view. In the same way that he's telling Luke's story through the point of view of a character that Luke can control and put a restraining bolt on, Luke's story is actually an entry in the Journal of the Whills, and the Whills use Luke as a vehicle, the same way that Luke can use 3PO as an appliance.
Chewie, take the professor in the back and plug him into the hyperdrive.
In the end, Luke's whole journey is that he must defeat his father to become his own person. Anakin's goal to get more power involves him defeating his master to become a master of his own. Lucas says that to the Whills we're like taxis, but he also says that they might be pushing us towards a destiny, but it's our choice if we want to follow how we're pushed. In this mythology, the Whills are God, or they are the Force, in the sense that they can control what's happening in us on a cellular level. But how much control the Whills actually have brings up the question of what type of intelligence or how much intelligence a single-celled organism really has. Lucas said in that James Cameron interview that in his plans for his sequel trilogy, he was going to get into a microbiotic world, and this is what he was talking about, explaining how all of this works. Of course, you know, clickbait websites who had no idea what he was talking about took this line and ran with it, saying that the next movies were going to shrink the characters down like a magic school bus story. Lucas never said anything like that. I don't think what Lucas is saying is that they think like us and that they're plotting and scheming in the way that we would think of that. He goes on to talk about other types of consciousness and intelligence, and he says that he believes that animals are aware and feel sorrow and have desire and communicate just in different ways than humans. There are a lot of different types of consciousness. The Whills know that the energy of the universe has to be in balance for them to live, because if it isn't, they can't thrive. So they can instinctively guide things in a way that makes the energy balance in the way that they need it. They live or die if they don't. As neuropharmacologist John Cyan talks about the microbiome of single-celled organisms within humans, he says, all of human development and all the systems in the body have evolved or co-evolved with our microbes. As humans, we are very much human-focused, and we feel that human cells and genes have primacy, but the microbes were there first. Humans evolved from microscopic life, and we need them, but they don't necessarily need us. You could look at humans as an extension of microscopic life, not the other way around. Since the microscopic life outnumbers us by trillions, for a larger perspective focused on how the whole universe is operating, not just on what humans do and what humans desire, you could view humans as a way for microscopic organisms to move around.
Anakin, if one is to understand the great mystery, one must study all its aspects, not just the dogmatic narrow view of the Jedi. If you wish to become a complete and wise leader, you must embrace a larger view of the Force.
Or, in other words, we're cars for them, like Lucas says. He says that you could view them as a more advanced form of life than humans. They accomplish interstellar travel on asteroids. They can be frozen and unfrozen and live for millennia. And the microscopic creatures inside of you do communicate with you and give you directions in a way. You need them in order to survive, so if something you're doing is making it impossible for them to live inside of you, you'll become sick or experience physical symptoms that you have to change your behavior in order to fix.
Human breast milk has co-evolved to nourish not only an infant's developing body, but also its microbes. Their unique molecular toolkits make enzymes, vitamins, and compounds that fight infection and disease. So it should come as no surprise that when the diversity of our vibrant microbial ecosystem drops, we get sick.
They might not be conscious exactly in the same way as us, but they are living beings just like us, and they're fighting for survival. Because they aren't conscious in exactly the same way as us, we don't think of them as having desires like we do. This is an example of us thinking that our level of existence or our way of viewing reality is the only important one, but Lucas is saying that there are other levels and other circles within circles. So this whole idea and all this stuff about the Whills and the midichlorians is simply another way of Lucas explaining one of the core themes of Star Wars.
So what I told you was true, from a certain point of view.
Some of the comments that I've got on my video about the prequel say that I'm just imagining the symbolism of circular shapes in the movies. Let's ignore for a minute that, in fact, Lucas has said it's intentional, so it's obviously not something I made up. But it's also not just circular imagery. It's rather that the symbols are used in a very specific way.
One of the reasons why Star Wars is so still so popular is because you can read lots of things into it. A lot of things are there. And George did tell me, he did tell me that it was his onion, so to speak. That's George Lucas's onion. I was with him in his writing room. He wasn't actually writing while I was there, but I was in his writing room. I did talk to him about the Indiana Jones movie for that book. And I was trying to read stuff into Indiana Jones. And George just stopped me and said, no, nothing. There's nothing going on underneath the surface of Indiana Jones. But he said, Star Wars, on the other hand, is like an onion. You can peel away one layer, and there's another layer and another layer. And he said that was all intended. So he did intend for the six films to be interrelated and for there to be deeper meanings.
So there's also there's a thematic issue going on here of sort of concentric circles of they're kind of in heaven, only when they fight, they're in this forgery. This red hell in the middle of this little capsule, sort of a world within a world within a world, rings of worlds, which is very Eastern in nature. They go to where they think they're going to get sanctuary, and they ultimately find the devil there. There's actually a lot of things like that going on, that if you were to peel the movies back, there's a lot of symbolism, a lot of motifs, and a lot of concentric circles going.
Lucas has talked specifically about how in Cloud City, it's designed in a circular way because the circles represent different levels of reality, and in this case, levels that you could call heaven or hell existing next to or within one another. And if you look at the sets, obviously it's much, much more than just, you know, some circles being thrown in for aesthetic reasons. You know, everything is circular and layered to have circles within circles. And this is something that you see throughout all the movies, with things like the pits that many of the lightsaber battles take place over. Those are circular. In each of the battles that happen over one of these pits, there's always the looming possibility that they could fall down the pit, which is obviously symbolic of them being killed in the battle. In Empire Strikes Back, Luke choosing to fall down the pit is explicitly meant to represent the part in the traditional hero's journey where the hero travels to the underworld and then returns. The idea of different levels of reality or the afterlife or levels of enlightenment being represented as concentric circles is something that's actually a common concept through various mythologies. Lucas mentions it being Eastern, but you can also find similar ideas in the levels of hell in Dante's Inferno and in many other places. The reason it's not particular to one religion or one philosophy is because it's a concept that different cultures can all arrive at independently because it's reflective of our common observable reality. You can see the same circular structures in stars, or in structures as big as galaxies, or structures as small as cells. The idea is that as you pull out in a larger point of view, you see the same structure repeated on different scales again and again, like a fractal. As Lucas is always talking about the movies communicating like visual jazz with different riffs on the same idea, he takes the same circular motif and he applies it to all different scenarios. It can represent light with the sun motifs, or dark with the Imperial logo. It can represent death with the Death Star, which is a circle within a circle, or it can represent life with the water spheres in Coruscant in the Coruscant Ballet. If you look closely at the spheres of water Anakin and Palpatine are sitting in front of when Palpatine talks to Anakin about the cell division that created him, you'll see that they look like a little solar system with smaller spheres orbiting a larger central one, but they also look like cells with smaller beings traveling around inside of them like mitochondria. The same image could represent either stars or cells, and they're orbiting each other as part of the same larger system. This takes us all back to Lucas's theme of symbiosis, which is really one of the main things he's trying to get at with all of this.
They live inside me.
Inside yourselves, yes. And we are symbionts with them.
Symbionts?
Life forms living together for mutual advantage.
You and the Naboo form a symbiont circle. What happens to one of you will affect the other. You must understand this.
Think of it like a city. All the people who live and work there have their own lives, but they rely on each other for things like food, clothing, and other services. Together, they bring the city to life.
Bringing midichlorians into it as a device is something that existed from the beginning, but I never really had the time to go into any explanation, because every time these rather larger concepts come into play, you know, how does the galaxy work, you know, what is the force, all this kind of stuff, you have to be very sort of cryptic and deal in almost fortune cookie descriptions of things, and so it's very difficult to get a concept across. And I also like the idea of this symbiotic relationships, which is an ongoing theme in the whole movie, of people helping people, that there may be a completely different race of life form that lives inside your body, completely independent of you, but has some influence over you. I think for some of the audience, it goes right past without them being able to follow it. But like all the Star Wars films, the more you sort of see it over and over again, and the more you understand what's going on, after a while it'll make perfect sense, because there is a logic to it all that's been put in there.
It's just that you can't have the light side without the dark side. We're all part of an interconnected universe, and we all think that it's just about us, but really we can't exist without everything outside of us and around us and connected to us. It's just like how the circular theme and imagery can represent scientific realities like cells or galaxies, but it's equally a symbol for the spiritual messages of the movies about coexistence and interdependence.
The Force is what gives the Jedi his power. It's an energy field created by all living things. It surrounds us and penetrates us. It binds the galaxy together.
All energy from the living force, from all things that have ever lived, feeds into the cosmic force, binding everything and communicating to us through the midichlorians.
Life creates it, makes it grow. Its energy surrounds us.
You can notice, of course, that what Obi-Wan says in the very first Star Wars movie about the Force being generated by living beings lines up exactly with what the characters would later say when they elaborate on the concept and talk about the living force and the cosmic force and all of that. Like I point out many times in my prequels video, Lucas didn't change his mind about these things over the years. The fans just had partial information and they made some bad guesses about its full meaning.
The idea of the Force goes back to THX, talk about not throwing out an idea. THX-1138, there's a scene that was cut where they talk about how there's a force that sort of underlies everything. Mm-hmm. And then in the rough draft, it resurfaces as the force of others. They say, may the force of others be with you.
I haven't changed much over the years. It's funny, if you were to see all the films, you begin to see that there's a certain continuity of eccentric taste that flies through those movies.
By explaining midichlorians and the Whills, Lucas isn't explaining away anything mystical or spiritual about the Force. He's illustrating how it affects the galaxy on a macro scale and on a micro scale, and he's showing us that it's much more than an ability to sword fight or to levitate objects. The people who say that these explanations somehow reduce the idea of the Force or make it smaller or less spiritual are actually complaining because Lucas is describing something that's so much larger and more profound than they can wrap their minds around.
He did tell me that it was his onion, so to speak. That's George Lucas's onion.
There's actually a lot of things like that going on, that if you were to peel the movies back, there's a lot of symbolism, a lot of motifs, and a lot of concentric circles going.
But he said Star Wars, on the other hand, is like, you know, you can peel away one layer, there's another layer, another layer. And he said that was all intended. So he did intend for the six films to be interrelated, and for there to be deeper meanings.
Now, these are eyes that analyze movies.